I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Bill S. Ballinger's best-selling novel of The Pursuit of a Damned Couple. The Wife of the Red-Haired Man. Starring Patty Duke-Astin. John Astin. And Howard Duff. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour. This week's story draws its title from an ancient Irish poem. Here's the last verse. But the day of doom shall come, and the hills and harbors be rent. A mist shall fall on the sun from the dark clouds heavily sent. The sea shall be dry and the earth under mourning and ban. Then loud shall he cry for the wife of the red-haired man. It's the tale of the hunted and the hunter, the pursuer and the pursued, the stalking of life and death. Do you believe, as I do, that the hunter and his quarry build an empathy between them? A sympathy? As the chase builds toward the inevitable conclusion, is it possible that, subconsciously, they become aware of each other's moves, counter-moves, plans, even emotions? There are two individuals who will tell you that's so. The poet and the cop. Our story begins after this word. Picture this. A windy, rainy November night in New York City. A man about 30, his most identifiable feature, a crest of flaming red hair, stands in a public telephone booth.
Rohan?
This is the Turner house. There's no one. Rohan? Did you say Rohan? Hello? Who is this?
The red-haired man wears no raincoat. When he pulls up his jacket collar, we see a revolver stuck into his trousers. The red-haired man walks to the end of the street, where he turns and is lost to our view. His destination is East Vander's Place, a small exclusive street near the river, where large apartments cost a lot of money. Inside one of them, a married couple, Albert and Mercedes Turner.
Quiet.
What? Oh, am I? I'm sorry.
Would you care to tell me who called?
There wasn't anyone.
I heard you asking questions. You told someone this was the Turner house. You said another name. What was it? I've forgotten.
It wasn't anything. It couldn't have been.
You lie badly. And you lie a great deal of the time.
Don't, Albert. Please, don't bait me.
The door?
Yes.
Shall I?
No. No, I'll get it.
Hello, Mercy.
You. It is you. Oh, you.
I tried to warn you. I called, but then I lost my nerve. I froze. Oh, Mercy. Mercy.
Mercedes? Who's at the door? Mercedes?
Come in, Hugh.
Who is it?
It's someone who... Albert, it's someone who...
It's all right, Mercy. It's all right.
Well, if you're through kissing my wife, come in and let me get a look at you.
Come in, darling. Come in.
Well, introduce us, my dear.
I'm Hugh Rohan.
Am I supposed to know you?
Mercy, didn't you...
Hugh's my... I thought he'd been killed in Vietnam.
Rohan? Oh, of course, that's the name you said on the phone.
The last time I saw Mercy, she was my wife.
Your wife? Mercedes, is that so?
Yes. I was Hugh's wife. Long ago.
Did you just forget to tell me, my dear? Slip your mind, did it? That you were already married when you jumped into my bed?
Don't talk to her like...
I wasn't married. I'd obtained an Enoch Arden decree.
You divorced me?
Well, then, at least you're not a bigamist. Whatever else you might be.
Why, Mercy? Why did you do it?
7 years, Hugh. They said you were missing in action, presumed dead. I waited 7 years, darling.
For a con.
What?
You waited 7 years for a convict. Missing in action? Don't make me laugh.
Hugh, what does he mean?
I mean he's a con. He has the stink of prison all over him. Haircut, prison-issue shoes... Unless he's anemic, he hasn't seen the sun all those 7 missing in action years.
What's he talking about, Hugh?
Put that phone down.
Oh, my dear phony fellow, it's my duty as a public-spirited citizen to tell the police there's an escaped con in my living room.
Put it down.
If you come near me, I'll blow your head off.
Put that gun away, Albert, please. Please, put the gun away.
Operator.
Albert?
He's dead.
You shot him.
He was going to call the police and spoil it. I waited 7 years, Mercy. 7 years!
But he's dead. What will happen to us? I don't remember if I'd ever seen a dead body before. But Hugh faced the matter as though it were almost commonplace. He hung up the phone, which had fallen to the floor, and then closed Albert's eyes.
He would have separated us again. I couldn't let him do that.
Was it true? What he said about you?
No.
We can't stay here.
Then we'll leave. You take what you need, and we'll leave together.
No. Not yet.
What?
I can't leave until tomorrow. We'll need money.
Oh, yeah. All right. I'll stay with you until morning.
No, you have to leave now while it's dark. Otherwise, someone might see you.
What about him?
We'll put him in his room. The maid comes at 10 o'clock. We don't want her to find him right away.
All right. Where do you want him?
His bedroom. I'd better answer it. It might be the operator. Maybe she traced his call.
Where's this bedroom?
Through that door, the room on the right.
All right, if that's the operator, tell her everything's fine. We were playing a game and the phone fell off the table.
Hello?
Al?
What?
Al there?
Albert? Did you want to talk to Albert?
Let me talk to Al.
Who is it? Is that the operator?
Someone wants to speak to Albert.
Not Albert. Al. What's the matter? Are you drunk? I want to talk to Alan. Alan Fox. My goodness, can't you understand a simple request?
Alan Fox.
That's it.
You have a wrong number. There's no one here by that name.
Oh, I'm most extremely sorry.
I thought it was someone... I don't know, someone who heard us or saw us through a window. I was frightened.
It's all right. Everything's all right now. We're together.
Yes.
And we'll always be together because that's how it was meant to be.
Go now, while it's dark. I'll get the money in the morning.
Then come to the rooming house where I'm staying. Here's the address. I wrote it down so I wouldn't forget.
All right. In the morning. Good night.
Good night.
My name is Williams, detective of 19th Precinct. Not every detective working on a murder in New York City belongs to the homicide squad. A detective from the precinct where the killing occurs is also assigned to it. East Vanda's place is in the 19th, and therefore the report of Albert Turner's death came over our desk, and I went out on it. The medical examiner and the technical services crew were already there when I arrived.
Williams, over here. Hey, you precinct guys sleep in or what? It's almost noon.
Only got it half hour ago. When was homicide here?
Half hour ago. I just got here.
Oh, this is quite some beautiful layout.
Yeah, it's class. Real dough.
Who reported it?
A maid, Thelma Jordan. She found the body. Miss Jordan? Turner's her boss. She'll tell you about it.
Yes, Mr. Scores.
This is Detective Williams here, Miss Jordan, 19th Precinct. He'll be working with me on this.
Hello. Tell me where you found Mr. Turner.
Well, the poor man was in his bedroom. I thought he was asleep, lying in bed, covers all drawn up.
He live here alone?
Oh, no, sir. They're married.
Is it Mrs. Turner?
Oh, yes, indeed.
Well, where is she?
Well, I'm sure I don't know. She wasn't here this morning when I came in.
She at work?
Oh, no, sir. She don't work.
Well, isn't Mr. Turner usually up and around?
Oh, yes, sir, but this morning Miss Turner left me a note. Here.
Let me see that. Thelma, Mr. Turner wasn't well last night. Don't awaken him. He needs the rest. Mercedes Turner. Dr. Branch from the medical examiner's office. He's with the body.
What do you suppose happened to Mrs. Turner?
I can't even guess.
Morning, Will.
Doc. What happened?
One shot straight in the ticker.
Fully clothed. Suit, shoes, lying under covers.
Tell me, Doctor, did you close the eyes?
No, but somebody did.
Who? His wife?
Remind me to ask her when we find her. Also, how come she didn't notice a dead husband in the bedroom?
This is a man's room. Apparently, they had separate bedrooms.
How long has he been dead?
It's a guess. I'd say since around midnight.
Another guess for you, Doc. Possible suicide?
Negative. No powder stains in the front of his shirt. There's at least none I can find without a microscope. Besides, when
I... There's no gun.
That's right.
There is one. We haven't found it yet.
Another thing, you'll notice that not much bleeding. Probably shot someplace else, then placed in the bed.
Any idea where?
Possibly. The technical boys found something in the living room.
Oh? What?
Possible blood stain on the rug. They clipped the sample and they're going to check it.
Near the bar by the phone.
Yeah. Shot as he was calling someone?
Maybe.
You know, when I got here, this chair had been pulled up to cover that stain. The boys nearly missed it.
Yeah. Oh, Miss Jordan?
Yes?
Listen, does Mrs. Turner have a book where she keeps phone numbers, you know, stores, shops, beauty parlor, places where she might be this morning?
Yeah, I'll get it.
And would you check her things for us, see if anything's missing?
Yeah, right away.
Where do you suppose she is, Will?
I don't know. Can't even guess.
Think maybe something's happened to her?
It's possible, Scores. It's very possible.
It happened so suddenly. All of it. Hugh returned from the dead, holding me in his arms. Suddenly we were young again, and innocent. Then Albert began saying those terrible, threatening things. Of course Hugh had shot him. If I'd had a gun, I would have too. Hugh killed him for me, really. Now we had to get away. I couldn't sleep that night, alone in the apartment with Albert's body. In the morning, I gathered some clothes, including my fur coat, left a note for Thelma Jordan, the maid, and hurried to the bank.
Mrs. Turner, good morning. How nice to see you.
Good morning, Mr. Forrest.
How may we serve you? Is Mr. Turner feeling well?
Oh, yes, thank you. Would you cash this check for me?
Yes, certainly. $4,500. Are you closing your account?
Oh, I wouldn't dream of it. No. If you promise you won't tell Albert.
Not a word.
Well, I'm being terribly extravagant. I simply can't resist a lovely new car, and I promise to pay the difference in cash.
And surprise Albert.
Exactly.
Of course.
Oh, and while you're getting the cash, I promised Albert I'd bring him some papers he left in our safe deposit box.
The money will be here when you get back.
Thanks so much.
Mercy? Oh. Oh, Mercy.
Oh, Hugh. My love.
Come in. Leave the bag where it is. Here. Let me have your coat. Where have you been? I thought it's too good to be true. She's gone to the police. She's told him what happened.
No. No, darling. I withdrew money from the bank and took my jewelry from the safe deposit.
Doesn't matter. You're here. That's all that's important. 7 years, Mercy. I waited 7 years to be with you. 7 empty years. I just don't seem to be able to function without you.
Hugh. What did Albert mean when he called you a convict?
Oh, nothing. Forget it. Come on. Come here. Come here with me. Here, sit down.
Was it terrible? All those years?
I told you, I'm not complete without you. Oh, Mercy.
We can't stay here, darling. The police will be looking for us.
I know.
Hugh?
Yeah.
I felt the same way. Incomplete. All the while you were gone. You're all I've ever really had, my darling. You're everything that makes me warm and soft. Oh, you.
There's certain procedures you set in motion after a homicide. You looked at the deceased's enemies. You question everyone who might know something about what happened at the time of the crime. You make sure the lab is checking fingerprints and possible blood stains, lost bits of hair, anything and everything. In my job, you're trying to solve a puzzle. When you first begin, there's nothing there. Yes, sir, I certainly will.
Hey, who was that?
The commissioner. Want to know what we have? They're asking questions upstate, you know.
Well, tell me, Will, what has the 19th been able to come up with in how long? 6 hours since we got the call?
Well, we have a dead man and a missing wife. I called the phone numbers the maid found for me, beauty parlor and such. No one's seen her for the last day or so.
The lab's pretty sure Turner was shot in the living room. They think that bloodstain near the phone will match his type.
That's great. Turner shot in the living room near the phone. With a bullet in his heart, he walks into the bedroom and gets settled down under the covers, which is where he expires. Which leaves us at square one. Someone shot Turner in the living room, carried him to the bedroom, shut his eyes, then left the premises for who knows where.
That someone being Mrs. Turner, huh?
That's all we have at the moment.
Well, maybe we got a little more, Will.
What do you mean?
According to the maid, Mrs. Turner's overnight bag is missing, along with a few dresses, shoes and things, mm-hmm. and a fur coat, some bracelets, earrings, etc.
Mm-hmm. All right. We'll find the lady. Mrs. Mercedes Turner. Last seen when last night?
Yeah, as far as we know.
Carrying an overnight bag. Wearing a fur coat. Let's see. Height. You got a picture of her?
From the apartment, you mean?
Yeah, from the apartment. Every dummy in the world has snapshots. Weddings, picnics, holidays, trips, whatever.
Not this lady.
What?
We tore that place apart, Will. There is no picture of her. We're putting out on all points for Mercedes Turner, and we don't have the faintest idea what she looks like.
Because we didn't have a photograph of Mercedes Turner, scores of homicide interviewed people who knew the woman, and from their descriptions produced a police artist drawing of her. By nightfall, this picture would be circulated to airlines, bus depots, train stations, shipping agents, everywhere where Mercedes Turner might be seen. Meanwhile, I began to check into the missing woman's background, searching for some clue to her whereabouts. Mercedes Turner's maiden name was Clinton. Her home had been in Mountain Forge, Connecticut. I drove up there. The police station was across the street from the railroad depot. I parked and went inside. It's not a state officer. I need cooperation from the local police. Excuse me. I'm looking for Chief Novak.
Speaking to him. You the officer called me from New York?
Wiggins, that's right.
How long did it take you?
Less than 3 hours.
Too close. We folks here feel about city cops.
Well, I just realized I was in a popularity contest.
Mercedes Turner, you said on the phone.
Yes. You know her?
Yeah. And she was a little girl. Name was Clinton, before she was married.
What was she like?
Nice kid. Real pretty, lively. Blonde hair, big blue eyes.
She ever get in any trouble around here?
Nope. Caution her once in a while against speeding the mic too fast. Lyman Clinton, her dad, gave her a little yellow car when she first went away to school. Drove it all over. Real fast sometimes. You know kids.
Clinton's are pretty well off.
Don't worry where the next meal's coming from.
Old family in these parts?
Tolerable. 4 or 5 generations.
Was Mercedes an only child?
Yeah. Light of Lyman's eye. Mighty proud of her. Maybe a mite too proud.
How's that?
I sort of always figured he knew what was best. Nothing good enough for her, in Lyman's view. Regardless what she wanted. You believe she shot her own husband?
I don't know. What's your opinion?
If she wanted to bad enough, she might have. Except one thing don't line up. What I know about Mercedes.
What's that?
Well, she was brung up proper. Knows right and wrong. And maybe she got mad in blazes. Even had good enough reason to shoot her husband. But if she did it, she'd take a medicine. She'd walk in and hand you the gun. Well, you see. You see what I mean when you meet her daddy.
We left Hugh's terrible little room hand in hand, like young lovers off on an adventure. I knew we had to get out of the city, and so did Hugh. We took a bus across the river to Jersey City and got off on a bleak street lined with used car lots, garages, auto parts stores, crawling and sprawling beside one another. We bought an afternoon newspaper and ducked into a shabby little diner and ordered coffee. Here it is, see?
They found him.
Yes. But they don't know about you. They're looking for a woman alone. They're looking for me.
Mercy, after I left last night...
I took every picture of myself I could find and Albert's gun and threw them away.
Ah, that's good. Now, gotta get away from here.
Where should we go?
Anywhere. It doesn't matter. Just leave before they find out about me.
Yes. I thought we'd buy a car.
That's good. That's good. The police will expect you to take a plane or a bus or whatever.
All right. Wait for me. I'll get a car.
Be careful. Be very careful.
Chief Novak and I had lunch, and then I called New York and talked to Scores. He got me all points bulletin out on Mercedes Turner with her description, and was in the tedious business of checking out everywhere she might have gone. Friends, neighbors, stores, everything. So far, he'd come up empty. The woman had simply disappeared. I was approaching the puzzle from the other direction, trying to find a connecting thread from her earlier days. Chief Novak drove me out to her father's house. Big old farmhouse set back from the road by a twisting gravel drive. Huge trees towered over the house like great leafy umbrellas.
Come in.
Simon Clinton, the woman's father, was tall and thin, a bit stooped. He had a long, thin face with creases running from cheek to nose. Snow-white hair. He led Novak and me into a study off the big living room. He motioned us to a couple of worn, shiny leather chairs and seated himself behind an old-fashioned roll-top desk. It was a genteel, patrician background for a woman I was beginning to suspect of murder.
Chief Novak says you want to talk about my daughter.
That's right, Mr. Clinton.
Now, before we get started, if I did know anything, I doubt I'd tell you. Furthermore, I'll never believe she shot Albert Turner.
Did she have any reason to shoot him?
None I know about.
Anyone else want to shoot him? You hesitate.
Just thinking.
Would Mrs. Clinton have any information?
Quite sure she wouldn't.
Miss Clinton's gone now. Buried better than 5 years.
I'm sorry, I didn't realize. When was the last time you saw your daughter?
A couple of weeks ago. Dinner one night in the city.
You see her often?
My daughter and I are very close. Sometimes she comes up here or else I go to New York.
When did she marry Albert Turner?
A little over a year ago.
You have a picture of her?
No.
Not even a wedding picture?
You heard me. I don't like pictures.
Well, there's one over there. Mrs. Clinton?
Yes. That's the exception.
And if you had a picture of Mercedes, you wouldn't give it to me anyway, would you?
Williams, I think maybe we better move along.
Mm-hmm. All right. Thanks for your time, Mr. Clinton.
It was while I was buying the car that the questions began gnawing at me. Questions about Hugh. When the war in Vietnam began, Hugh had been one of the first to be drafted. He shipped out very soon after his induction, and then nothing. No word, no trace, nothing. The Red Cross helped me, but all we could learn was that he was missing. Missing in action, they said. The man, as years went by, presumed dead. But I waited. And I felt myself drying up. Aging without him.
Is this the car? It's not bad.
This is it.
What name do you use?
Mrs. Walter Brewer. Trenton, New Jersey.
Slide over. I'll drive.
Do you have a license? You've been away a long time.
Yours isn't good now either. Has your right name on it. What's the difference? If we're stopped, that's it for both of us.
Yes.
Nice to be driving. I didn't think it would happen.
Going?
Away. Far, far away. You and me, Mercy. Just the way it used to be.
Yes. Just the way.
After we left Mercedes Turner's father, Chief Novak had someone else he thought I should see. A woman, Clara Goldwater, who'd been close to Mercedes in high school. Clara was married now, wife of a foundry worker in Mountain Forge.
I'll wait here.
Their home was a squatting, shapeless bungalow in a shabby, genteel sort of neighborhood. You've seen a million places like it. Mrs. Battles?
Yes?
You used to be Clara Goldwater, a friend of Mercedes Clinton?
Oh, yes.
My name is Williams, New York Police. Chief Novak is out in my car. May I come in?
Oh, yes, come on. This time of day, she's cranky. Sit down, please.
Thank you.
What do you want?
A little information about Mercedes Clinton Turner.
Whatever for?
She's disappeared.
Just gone?
Something like that.
Oh, my goodness.
I know you're busy. This won't take long. When did you last see Mercedes?
Oh, not in ages. Years. In high school. Then we sort of drifted apart.
But you remember her well.
Oh, yes. Such a beauty.
Mm.
Never say that about me. I was the plain one. But we were real close friends, at least for a while. Then she went her way and I went mine. Settled down here. You ever meet her husband?
Albert Turner.
What kind of man is he?
Quiet, when I saw him.
Quiet, kind of. Kind that broods over things?
Did he have something to brood over?
Might have. You think Mercy's in trouble? Real trouble?
Yes. She's in a great deal of trouble.
Enough to make me break my word?
Mrs. Battles, if you know anything at all, you should tell me.
Oh, Mercy made me swear. Really, swear on the Bible I'd never tell a soul. Even after Daddy found out about it and broke it up.
Yes?
Well, Mercy was married before.
Did Albert Turner know that?
Well, after it was over, after her daddy broke it up, Mercy wouldn't talk about it, not a word. So I don't suppose Albert Turner did know about it.
How long ago did this happen?
Oh, long, long ago. Years ago, it seems. Back when the Vietnam War began, back then. They ran away to get married. I was supposed to be a witness, but I couldn't go at the last minute, and they went ahead, did it anyhow.
Who was the man? Who'd she marry?
A boy she met in Prester.
Well, she was going to school there?
Must have been, so long ago. I remember he was poor. And they were both awful young and so much in love. They were going to keep it a secret.
What was the boy's name?
His last name was Rohan. Can't recall his first name. What a pretty picture they made.
In what way?
Well, she was so blonde and he had red hair, flaming red hair, like he was on fire.
He drove carefully, partly because he wasn't used to being behind a wheel, partly so he wouldn't do anything to make a policeman stop us. We drove south without even discussing why. I found myself staring at him, at the flaming red hair, the boyish face, tired now, worn. He must have felt me staring at him because he shifted in the seat to look at me. That's when I saw that he was still carrying the gun in his jacket pocket. Hugh?
Yeah?
Should you keep the gun? Shouldn't you get rid of it?
No, I have to keep it. You'll see.
See what?
Well, if anything happens, if anyone tries to stop us, break us up, now that we've found each other again, I may need to use it. Because there's nothing in this world can take you away from me again. Hey, remember Rehoboth Beach?
Yes, of course I remember.
That's where we're going. A second honeymoon, Mercy.
Huh? It's winter. Will anything be open?
We don't need more than a room.
And the police won't look for us there.
All the police are watching for right now is a single woman. They don't know about the car, or the jersey plates in the car, or about me. We're going to have our second honeymoon, Mercy.
According to Clara Battles, Mercedes Turner had met her first husband while she was a student at the Bentley Collegiate Institute in Preston. I drove up there and then called New York to tell Scores what I'd gotten.
So she may not be alone, huh? She could be traveling with this red-haired guy, Rohan.
I suspect that's true. Otherwise, why did she run?
Well, panic.
After spending the night with her dead husband? This isn't a lady who panics.
Okay, Will. I'll add him to the APB.
Right. I'll be back late tonight or first thing in the morning.
Yeah, we'll see you then. Oh, Will.
Yeah?
Hold up a minute. Something just came in. Hey, what do you know? The lady went to her bank this morning, closed her account, and took a bunch of stuff from her safe deposit box.
Well, it just goes to prove you can't live on love alone. See you. I pride myself on my ability as a police officer. I like my job, and I think I do it well. I've learned in the years I've been at it that a good cop gets a fix on a suspect, begins to empathize with the suspect, and pretty soon it's as though the person you're looking for was carrying a homing device. You begin to zero in on him. I began to get a feeling about the red-haired man. The Preston Town Constable steered me to a place called the Snack Bar, where the Bentley girls hang out after classes. It's run by a nice old man, Clement Beatty.
How long we been here? Oh, my, we've had the place for years.
You recall a young fella hung around here back before the war? His name was Rohan.
A red-haired boy?
That's him.
Oh, yes, yes. He was with us for about a school year. Worked here in the shop for me and the missus. Why'd you want to know?
I'm trying to locate him. Where's his family with?
Well, seems to me out west someplace, or Middle West, maybe.
Hmm. How'd he happen to work for you?
Well, he was planning to go to Annixter College up in Royal. Came down here to see about a job. Mother and me leave a standing invitation, you know, registrar's office up there for a deserving boy to help us out.
Why was he so far from home?
He wanted to be a doctor. And Annixter's one of the best pre-med schools in the country, you know.
Yeah. Do you recall a girl at Bentley about that time, Mercedes Clinton, pretty, with blonde hair? She was very close to you.
Oh, yeah, sure. Was that her name, Mercedes? Oh, sure, sure. Yeah, after Hugh closed the shop, the two of them used to sit back there and talk to all hours.
Oh.
Well, you know, young kids in love. Yeah, I recall one night I was cleaning up in the kitchen, couldn't help overhearing them. They were making plans, you know, for the future, how he was going to be a doctor. They were going to have a family. How did it all come out?
Not very well, I'm afraid.
We rented a tiny cabin at Rehoboth Beach, close by the water. And that night we slept in each other's arms for the first time since you'd gone off to war. I was awakened later. I don't know what time it was. By the sound of a sudden storm. Lying there, I was aware that Hugh was also awake.
Mercy?
Yes, sir.
Why'd you marry Turner? Did you love him?
No. Not ever. I married him because... I don't know.
You didn't love him?
Never. In fact, for the last few months, I've hated him. I wondered how to get away.
But you married him.
Yes, dear, I married him. Because there no longer was you, and all I wanted from life was to be protected. I didn't want love or pain anymore.
Mercy.
Yes, dear.
He was right, you know. Your husband was right.
About what?
I was a convict. I am a convict. I escaped from prison last week.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, The Wife of the Red-Haired Man. I'm Rod Serling.
Today's episode brought to you in part by Quaker State and Presto. This is the Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
You have been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater, heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow and once again...
rest your eyes and listen here.
...to The Zero Hour.
This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.